today I'm here to talk about entities. But I have some other contributions as well. So you might know me from rules. So I'm like the original creator of the rules module and also its main maintainer. Or entity by the entity module in Drupal 7 or some other contrib modules like field collection or profile 2. I'm also a Drupal core subsystem maintainer of the form system and entity API. And I was one of the driving forces behind of the Drupal 8 entity API initiative. Like initiative because it's not an official initiative. It was just like an self-running initiative, not one of the official appointed ones. So entities in Drupal 7 were really just a side effect of the field API being decoupled from nodes. So that was introduced very late in the Drupal 7 development cycle. So the entity API in Drupal 7 is basically unfinished. So that's what led to the creation of the entity module. And so entity module really completed it and added all the things that we needed to be able to work with entities properly in Drupal 7. So that worked rather good, but of course it was not an ideal solution. So, hey.
Can I just do one quick announcement?
Sure, go ahead.
Chcel som len povedať, že pripomenúť, teda, že o 18.30, toto je posledná prednáška, takže krátky oznam, 18.30 sa stretávame na afterparty u kafe Jakub na Jakubovom námestí. O 11, budeme tam pravdepodobne pozerať futbal teda. Oni zavierajú o 11.00, presunieme sa o pár ulic ďalej do Ice Bar sa volá podnik a je to naozaj veľmi zaujímavý podnik, kde majú miestnosť, ktorá je minus 5 stupňov. A preto ten ice, hej. A ešte jedna dôležitá informácia, ak ste Slováci hlavne, Slovenská Drupal asociácia, teda, ktorá organizuje aj Drupal Camp, máme prihlášky za členov, teda ak sa chcete stať aktívnou súčasťou slovenskej Drupal komunity, ak sa chcete spolupodieľať na tom, ako vlastne urobíme Drupal na Slovensku zaujímavejším a lepším. Ja nechám prihlášky túto vpredu, kľudne si ich zoberte a odovzdajte buď mne, alebo Mirovi Michaličkovi a veľmi radi potom vám sa spojíme ďalej a budeme plánovať ďalej. Ďakujem za pozornosť a ešte raz ďakujem, že ste prišli na Drupal Camp.
And thank you.
Anything important to say in English as well?
No, it was announcement for Slovakia.
Okay. Okay. Back to entities. We can party later. So the entity module in Drupal 7 really completed the things, but for Drupal 8, we want to have the complete API in core. So the question really was when we started Drupal 8 is how are we going to do that? So the easy answer would be, okay, let's move entity module to core, but if you know it, it's obviously not the best answer because it really works around the limitations of Drupal 7 core. So for Drupal 8, we really want to have a proper solution which is done properly from scratch in Drupal itself. So the answer was no, we couldn't just put the entity module in core, but really worked on improving the entity system in core directly. So the goals for that is really were first of have class-based objects, which just really makes it more convenient to work with. In particular, now with Drupal 8 going all object-oriented programming. And besides of that, we also really wanted to have a unification of fields and properties, so it makes it more pleasant for developers to deal with. Oh. So I think the cable has some issues. sme, we can continue over there. I would be okay with that, but I mean, you could watch over there, or we just move. Yeah, it's better for understanding. So there are also code examples and things like that. So would be good to have them. Yes. Okay, so we can just continue. Okay. So I continue talking meanwhile, and hopefully it's going to work again. Yeah, so besides the unification of fields and properties, we also wanted to introduce metadata about fields and properties, so that solutions like rules or ctools and context can work from that. And finally, one of the goals was to have like a separate validation API so that it's possible to validate entities as independently of form submissions. So when you are working on an API, of course, you need to answer the question, so what are you dealing with? So what's an entity? And really the answer to that question ended up being its content. It's all of Drupal's content. But then also it's really just data that you are going to store and load and that you deal with in Drupal. So we ended up actually that all the things are entities. So it's really mostly everything in Drupal 8 is an entity. But there are still some two flavors of entities. So there's like content and configuration. And actually we ended up of having two different flavors of entities. So there are content entities and configuration entities. They both extend from a common interface, so they have some common base API, but additions which are special to the solutions of handling content and configuration. So interface-wise, there's like an entity interface, which every entity has, and then there's content entity interface and config entity interface, which then deals with the specialities of both. So when you work with entities, you always then mostly you differentiate based upon whether it's a configuration or a content entity, and to leverage the special features of both. But like foundational things like the entity manager is common to both. Like the entity manager is really the central service, which allows you to do basically fetch everything, to have every method that you need to work with entities. It's accessible via the entity manager. So as every other service in Drupal 8, it's just defined in the service container, and you can access it via the global Drupal class, but usually when you're working in an object, this would be the dependency that you inject in your object, so you inject the entity manager and work from there. So when you load an entity in Drupal 8, what you basically need to do is you get the entity manager, and from the manager you get the storage controller for your entity type. So in that case, we want to load a comment, so you just pass the entity type ID comment and load it, that's it. Then as said, entities are class-based objects, so the entity object of course has convenient methods on it, like methods for getting the entity type, label, ID, and so on. But of course, one really important thing that you need to do with entities is to access its values. That works rather straightforward, I would say. You just access them like plain object properties. So in that example, it's here the entity has a subject field, and you can access the value of the field just by using arrow value. If a field has multiple values, you can just use the array syntax as here to access individual items of the field. And the API also supports chaining. If you have entity references, there's some special arrow entity property which you can use and just to chain down the tree. So that's really convenient. There are also some special methods on content entities. related to fields. So like this has field, which tells you whether the entity has a field of a certain name. And as field items and field item lists are also objects, they also have methods on them which are convenient. So for example, given when you have a field item, you can always call getEntity to get the entity the field item is contained in. For changing values, it works very much the same way. You can just write into it and save the entity afterwards. So that's really straightforward, I think. So talking of configuration and content entities, so that really was the API for content entities and fields. So how does that work with config entities? Well, it's similar, but it's not the same, because like configuration entities don't have fields, but only properties. So if you have like a view, one example for a configuration entity, the name is just a property. So then the value of the name is just a plain string. But in the case of a content entity, everything on it is a field. So if you have the node title, the title is going to be an object again. So it's a field item list object and not a plain string. As everything is object-oriented, we have been also introducing methods which allow you to work with the entity types. So it's every entity type, or most of the entity types in core, come with a set of convenient methods that make sense for the entity types. And if you work with them, you can make use of it, and it's really straightforward. Instead of just accessing the title field directly as here, for nodes, we know there will be titles, and there's also a method to access it, so you can just use the getTitle method instead. Similar for all of the other built-in things for nodes, like there is published to check whether a node is published, and so on. Translation. Yeah, so you might have noticed from the code example so far, there are no languages in there. As in Drupal 7, you always had to pass the language context when you access a field value. So luckily, that's not needed anymore for Drupal 8. But of course, there needs to be a way to access translated values as well. So that works in Drupal 8 by getting a translation object. So the entity object has get translation method on it, and you just pass the language code, and then you get another entity object which has all the values in the language that you requested. So basically, you call get translation, get another object on it, and you work with the translation object as would it be the original entity. If you are like in a multilingual environment, you might want to have language fallback applied. In that case, you can use the get translation from context utility method, which will give you the translation in the right language depending on the current content language fallback mechanism. And of course, if you have a translation object, you can always get back the original untranslated entity just by calling get untranslated on the translation object. Entity objects also support iteration. So if you iterate over a content entity, you basically just get a list of field items. If you iterate over the field items, you get a list of field item objects, and then you can access the individual field item properties. So that's really the fixed structure that every field follows in Drupal 8, so it's really easy to work with that in generic fashion as well. So yeah, it's really all fields. Content entities do not have any properties. Really everything which is on the content entity is a field. So also like what you know from nodes, like the title, the status, that's all a field in Drupal 8. Talking of fields, usually there's a separate session about fields, because there were so many changes in the field API as well. But I can try to give you a short overview here also, so that you get an idea of what's changed. But in general, first off, fields are now, as all the things in content entities are fields, there are multiple flavors of fields. So there are base fields, which are the fields which an entity type defines, and the entity type comes with So like that, that is what typically in Drupal 7 would be all the properties. That's the base fields in Drupal 8. Then in addition to that, there are bundle fields. They are called bundle fields because they may vary by bundle. So it's like a node type that has different fields depending on the node type that are all in the bundle specific fields. Field API fields, as you know it, are referred to as configurable fields in Drupal 8. They are really not special as to other fields in general. They are just working with the configuration management system on top of the regular entity field API. So that means they are just configuration and UI driven, but else the API wise they are completely the same. They are basically just bundle fields. As the field API is implemented that way, that they are also always bundle fields. If you like manage fields on a user entity, they are related to the built-in user bundle. As said, they are backed by configuration and they are exposed via a hook to the general field system. Yeah, as said, there are many improvements to the field API in general, but like I think very important also for site builders is that there are many new field types which are included in Drupal Core, like entity reference, a simple date field, link and email field. Then there's configuration management built in, so you can easily deploy like your field configuration changes. And that I think is a very important point is that we have now decoupled features of the field API. So the storage layer or the widgets and formatters of fields are now decoupled and you can really decide what you want to use. So if you have a module, you can easily just use the field system only storage wise, but do your own widgets and formatters and mix and match. So it's really like decoupled systems, not that like when you use a configurable field that you have to use all of those anymore. And that really helped us to make widgets and formatters reusable. So the widgets and formatters that you are using and know from configurable fields, they are also now used for base fields. So like the node title uses now a formatter internally on the node form. Yeah, and the configurability is really optional. So when you provide a new entity type, and you provide some fields for it, you can also choose whether for example the format of the node title should be configurable and adaptable by users. So as a developer, you always have the flexibility of just reusing things or reusing the things and also allowing the user to change it. There are also some non-configurable new field types in Drupal Core which are just used internally and are not exposed via the user interface. Some examples of that are the UUID field, language field, or path fields. They basically come with some sort of built-in behavior, which in that example is mostly is about default values, like the language field or UUID fields just come with their own default value, and that's it. Field storage really changed in Drupal 8 as it's now part of the entity storage. In Drupal 7, like entity storage and field storage were two separate systems, but now it was changed that like each entity type is responsible of its own storage, including all fields. So I think that's a really good improvement and really helps to take control of the storage of a certain entity type. And makes it way easier that way also to support like entity types being stored in different storages, like if you want to do entities backed by MongoDB, for example. Talking of entity storage, it's like really there's a separate entity storage handler which is in charge of the complete storage of a certain entity type. So you have one class which is in charge and which controls it, and so you have also like one class which you can swap out and customize if you want to. What's really nice about the built-in database storage of Drupal 8 is now that you don't have to take care of the database schema of entities anymore manually. You just specify the fields that an entity type has and the database schema then is auto-generated based on that information. So for that, there's a separate component. It's like the schema handler classes, which take care of that and also of the changes. So if you update the module and you add a new field, then the schema handler takes care of the changes and is also going to do the database schema updates for you. That works as long as it doesn't involve any data migration. So if it involves data migration, it's going to follow like exceptions and basically says, okay, that's something that cannot be handled automatically, and in that case, you will have to write a migration. There's also some table mapping API for SQL-based entity storages. That's mostly necessary for modules like Fuse, which needs to work based upon the internal database table layout. So they basically have a way of introspecting the table layout and work from that. So as a regular module developer, I don't think that's something you have to work with a lot. So from the table layout here, I would say a short overview is that all the base fields basically now live in shared tables if the base field is not multiple. So it's like the general node tables, they still exist. It's just a little bit different as there are multiple tables now for all the combinations of having revisionable, translatable fields and so on. Saying so, fields are optionally revisionable and translatable. So if you define a base field, you can also define whether it's stored per revision or not, and whether it's stored by language or not. And the storage then takes care of making sure to create the right table. So that also means like you can change a field to become translatable later on, and it's going to adapt the storage for you. The same for entity types. Entity types have basically a flag which tells the system whether they are revisionable or translatable or not. And when it's changed, again, the entity schema handler is taking care of the changes. So that's really nice feature. So in that, like when there are entity types which are by default in core not translatable, they can be made translatable later on. And that means Drupal is taking care of the database changes, and then you have a working entity type that's fully translatable and comes with full translatable storage. So right now the schema changes have to be applied when running update PHP. So I think that's like convenient when you update a module, but a little bit strange right now is that also can happen when you enable a module via the user interface, then you suddenly have to run update PHP later on. There's an issue to improve that for like module enabling and uninstalling, but right now you still have to run update PHP in that case. But so in general, if you wanna know more about like entity storage, I can just suggest you to read the blog post by Plutch on Drupal Watchdog. It's a really good overview over the whole topic. So if you're interested in that, look at that article. So talking of storage, of course, it's nice if you can store a lot of things, but we need to query the data, as it's really useless. So in Drupal 8, it's really not okay anymore to query your database outside of your storage controller or the entity query service, of course, because of multiple reasons. First off, translation. It's all translated, so you never know exactly whether a field is translated right now or not, so that may change. So it's also the same for the schema changes. The translatability of the entity may change, so the internal table layout may change, or even someone might want to swap out the entity storage backend. So as developer, you cannot rely on the internal like table layout anymore. So to avoid that, you just use the entity query API. So compared to Drupal 7, fortunately, got improved. So there's no more property condition or field condition methods. It's just condition everywhere. So it's more straightforward and easier to work with. And the entity query in API in general works independently of the entity storage. Or if you write a custom entity storage, you can also provide an entity query service that comes with and works with your storage. Of course, it has language support, so you can filter by a certain translation and translated values of an entity type. And it also has aggregation support, so you can do things like counting. There's even relationship support, so you can do some basic queries across multiple relationships of entities, as long as all of those entity types are stored in the same storage backend. So some examples of that API look like that. You basically get a new instance of the entity query, pass the entity type, and then you just use condition method calls to supply your condition. So it works quite similar to the database API of Drupal 7, I would say. And the result, as in Drupal 7 entity query API, is always an array of entity IDs. But the structure is more straightforward, as this is just IDs. So basically, the workflow is always query for the IDs, and then if you need the data, you have to load the entities. What actually is quite good and efficient, because then the loading operation can take care of caching. So in Drupal 8, there's entity cache, and usually the load is fully cached. Yeah, so far we have only looked at how you can work with entities in general. So I want to give you a short impression of what you have to do to provide a new entity type. Actually, I think it's rather easy in Drupal 8, although it involves creating and defining possibly multiple classes. But there's really like one main class, it's the entity class. So it works really similar to the plugin system. So once you know the plugin system in Drupal 8, it's really straightforward to define a new entity type as well. So there's just a special folder for each module. It's the entity folder in which you place the class. So if you want to provide the node entity type, you would place the node class in there, and you put a special annotation on top of it so that the system is able to detect the entity type. So it's really the same as for plugins. So in that example, we see the definition of the command entity type. So there's the command class here, and it also has the special annotation on it. So there's one annotation type for content entities and another one for config entities. And then you basically have to provide the ID of the entity type and all of the handlers. So for the handlers, there are basically default classes for all of the things which you can use, but you can adapt them and customize them, as we see now in the following slides. But first off, really, of course, the entity type wouldn't be complete without defining any fields. So for the comment entity, you want to have, of course, some basic fields, like you always need IDs, but here it's like also the parent ID, and other fields like subject, and so you don't see here. But what you have to do is that you implement the base field definitions method. It's just a static method on the entity class. There you create field definition objects for every field that you want to have. And the field definition object has like methods to set all the things you can set on it, like you can specify translatability, revisionability, as I mentioned, and then all the things that you know basically from configuring fields of Drupal 7. Then the storage class, as said, is really in charge of storage. So there's a SQL content entity storage, which basically works out of the box. But as said, you're not supposed to make any database queries outside of the storage. So if there is some need that you cannot solve with entity query, and you need maybe for performance a direct query on the database or something, so the best way to do it is to just introduce a new method on the entity type storage, which can then do the direct database query. And that way, every other storage implementation already sees where all the database access is located and can easily swap it out. So, and then there are also some static methods for storage independent logic, which are directly on the entity class. So the command class, for example, here has a post save method, which will be invoked by the system automatically. So they are really similar to the hooks that you already know, but they're just invoked before the hook and provide a really nice way of defining like storage independent logic for your entity types. For rendering entities, there's the view builder. The view builder basically renders all the fields with the formatters by default. But of course, if you wanna customize something, you can just customize the view builder class by overriding the get build defaults. You can add some additional stuff to it. That's in core mostly used actually to customize caching. So you make sure you have the right cache tags and all the right cache granularity on your rendered entities. If you wanna render some entity, you can get the view builder via the entity manager and then just call view on it, and that's it. So it's really straightforward. For forms, there's like content entity form base class, which by default handles all the fields, but you can extend it to add some other stuff to the form or to customize it. For getting an entity form, you can get the form object also from the entity manager. So same approach again. But what's new here is also that there are like multiple operations for entity forms. So by default, there's the default operation for editing, but then also something like deletion is just a separate case of an entity form, and you can add more form operations. But so for customizing the deletion form, you again would just extend the default one, and you can easily override like the description, the question, and everything. For handling access, there's an entity access control handler. So you can customize the access control handler to provide some access logic to your entity, which then automatically is going to be picked up. And yeah, it's really straightforward. You just specify access based upon the operation, like in that example here. Operation is like passed in, so it's like view, edit, or delete. And for creation, there's actually a separate method you can override. There's also a concept of entity lists in core, which is actually only used for configuration entities in Drupal core. So basically, an entity list builder is just an object which helps with building a listing of entities. So in Drupal core, it's mostly used for administrative listings, like the listing of the node types that you have in your system. Why is that not used for content entities? Because in Drupal 8 core, that's all handled by views. So there was not much point in implementing all that API for content entities. Yeah, to work with a list builder, it's really works the same way. You get the list builder from the entity manager, pass the entity type ID, and then you just call render on it, and you get the rendered list. So you can really see there's a pattern behind the entity handlers. So the handlers, they really provide reusable functionality based up my well-defined interface. So for each of the handlers, there's an interface, and that's the contract for the API, for everyone, for the implementer, and for the user of the API. But the handlers, they really allow you to customize the aspects of your entity type. So with the base classes, we have base functionalities that you can easily use and rely on, but you can always take the class, override it, customize it to your needs, and the rest of the system is going to pick it up. And then finally, the concept of the handlers, it can be extended as new handlers can be provided by contrib. So contribs can that way also allow for easy per entity type customizations. If a module introduces some new functionality, I don't know if there's like rules which wants to provide maybe events for your entity types, you can do so based up on an entity handler. So it's very easy for every entity type to control how that works and to customize that functionality. Yeah, so speaking of that, I also want to show you how the entity validation API works in Drupal 8, as it's like completely new. So the API, as I mentioned in the beginning, is really decoupled from form validation because of the REST API. With REST submissions, of course, when you update an entity, you need to validate the data before you submit it. And you really need to make sure that it's fine before you save it to the database. So for that, you need to validate it. But of course, you don't want to define validation logic twice. So there needs to be a unique way of defining validation logic so that it can be reused by the form submissions and by the REST submissions. And that is what the entity validation API provides you with. So the API is built up in the Symfony Validation API, so that's integrated into Drupal 8, and that is based up on constraints, which are exposed as constraint plugins to the Drupal 8 system. So when you define a constraint, you have multiple options or multiple levels where you can put the constraint. So first off, you can define constraints for individual fields, and then you can like put constraints on the individual properties so that an individual property has separate constraints. Then you can define constraints on the field item level or for the whole field. So you can really put them on every level as well as like on the entity level if you have some general constraints which needs to deal with multiple fields and multiple values on the entity and doesn't constrain only a single field. So in the case of putting a constraint on a field, you basically can do that when you define the field base in the entity type. So here is like a regular base field definition. It has a method addConstraint where you can pass the constraint plugin ID, and that's it. That's really straightforward. There's an optional second argument where you can also provide some options to the constraint. But that really depends on the constraint, whether it takes some options or not. So the field types can also come with some default constraints. So for example, here is an example of the annotation of the link field type. It has here some constraint defined, which is by default there. So it has a link not existing internal constraint, which is just some baked-in validation logic that's running for all the link field items. Then finally, when you define a field item, you can add some default constraints on the properties of the field item. So here, in that example, you have the definition of the value of a field item, and you can just use the add constraint method here as well to put some constraints on it. So in that example, it specifies that the value may not be longer than 255 characters. Then, as mentioned, there can be entity-level constraints, which again are defaults, which you put in the type definition, so you can put it in the annotation. But as entity type generally works, you can also, as a module, add them via a hook. So you can use hook entity type build to add an entity-level constraint to some entity type of another module, or finally you can of course also use the alter hook to alter them. So here is an example of how it would look like if you put it in the annotation. So you, in the entity type annotation, you can just use here the constraint key to specify some default constraints for your entity type. So actually the entity changed constraint is an example of entity level constraints that are in Drupal core. So they basically do the validation that the entity is not changed by another user while you have been editing it. And you don't need to specify it manually. It's just an example here. It's actually coming out of the box for your entity type as soon as you implement the right interface for your entity type. So how can you use all those API? How can you validate an entity? It's not hard. You just call the validate method on it. What you get back is a list of violations. So it's a constraint violation list object. And to see whether validation passed, you just check whether the list is empty. So when the count is zero, there were no violations and everything is fine. So if there are violations, you can work with the violations objects based on the interface. They basically store the message in the violation message, and they also tell you where the validation happened. So that's like get property path. So that's the path to the field or to the property which failed violation. So in that example, it was the format of the field test text field of the first item which failed violation. And finally, of course, you can also provide some custom constraint plugins. So there's really a lot of plugins that are already available. There are also a lot of plugins which already come with Symfony Validator, which you can easily add in. And make so you can make use of the existing validation logic. But in addition to that, of course, you can define your own ones to add your own validation logic that doesn't exist yet. So it's just a regular plugin as others, so it works the same way as for all the others. But what's different is that you need to have two classes. So first off, there's the constraint class, and then there's another class, the constraint validator, which actually contains the validation logic. So the constraint class only contains some options, if there are any, and it also contains properties for all the violation message that exist for your constraint. And they just work the usual way for Drupal, so they can have like replacement patterns, which work just like the regular way. So you can use the percent symbol and everything in there. So there's also the validated by method. The validated by method returns the class, which is the actual validation class, which contains the validation logic. And that class, the validator, basically just needs to implement the validate method. It gets the value that you need to validate and also the constraint, which may contain your constraint options. So you do your validation logic. And if there is a violation that you want to add, you just call add violation to tell the system that there was a violation, and that's it. So the violations that result of an entity validation are handled by the system automatically. It's basically all done by the entity form, but it basically works like that, is that field widgets are responsible of mapping the violations to the form elements, and they are also filtered based upon visibility. So if there is like a field that doesn't appear on a form, its violations will be ignored. So that just makes sure that if there is a form and the entity is already not valid in the beginning, the user can still edit it. So far I've talked a lot about entities and mostly talked about content entities, but I want to also shortly mention how it works with config entities and what things are different. So first off, like there's a different annotation on top of it, and then of course then there's a different storage by default. So there's the storage which stores to the configuration system. So the configuration entities are obviously not based upon SQL. But the basic principles are the same. You have an entity class here, and you also have the annotation on top. You have the interfaces and the methods for them. What's different is that you don't have fields. So you just define plain properties instead of defining base fields. The properties then will just have plain values of whatever you want it to be. Oops, I should have plugged it in the battery. So when you have a configuration entity, actually what controls what's gonna be stored for your entity is the toArray method. By default, it just returns all the properties that you define on the class, but you can also override the toArray method to customize things. Yeah, so that's it. I hope I was able to give you some overview of the all of the changes. I know it's a rather huge topic and a lot of things changed, but I hope I was able to give you a good start. So any questions to that? Okay, then I guess it's time for the party. Thanks.